Mr. Subodh, Kumar, if you can please come in. Professor Raman Mittal. Ms. Lakshika Joshi, I think she is still in the other hall, and Professor James Nedumpara. So I come from the legal practitioner's background, and I try to make sure that we have industry participation from Indian company, and Mr. Subodh Kumar is from TCS. I'm still waiting for Lakshika, who's most likely on her way. Ojasvita, if I can ask, can you ask someone to call Lakshika, please? So, and then we have Professor Raman Mittal from Campus Law, Delhi University. And of course, distinguished academician, Professor Nedumpara, somehow representing the government in the sense he has very newly been the head and professor of the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade. And with that, I'm not going into the details of the speakers here because I would prefer no intervention from the management and the discussion be as lively as possible. We are talking today of IP monetization as a model. Whenever we talk about IPR, we talk of IP enforcement. We always talk of IP enforcement. Sorry, but I do apologize. In my session here, we have two rapporteurs, Ms. Shirin Moti. Can you please stand up, Ms. Moti? So she's a lawyer as well as an academic. She studied in Queen Mary's, done her LLM, and she is the rapporteur. She is guided by Ojasvita, Ms. Ojasvita Srivastava there. And she's also had done her LLM from Queen Mary's, both quite in depth in policy research and publications. So coming back to the subject, whenever we talk about intellectual property rights, we usually always look at enforcement. But the point is, if we do not link up monetization and enforcement, then the ecosystem would not move, the ecosystem would not thrive. So when we talk of monetization, IP monetization, there can be many types of monetization. There can be manufacturing and in the sense doing R&D, creating IP, registering the IP, and then using that IP for manufacturing. That is one model. Or there can be licensing model. But whatever you do, whichever sector you pick up, whether it is an inventive industry, whether it's a copyright creative industry, licensing in and licensing out is extremely important. So without licensing, nothing will work. So we have picked up for our discussion today licensing. And may I, how we'll run it? I think still that we have 1 hour. And that's what we were told. So we'll introduce the topic gradually by each of the speakers. And for 5 minutes, each 4 or 5 minutes, they will introduce the topic, whatever will pose a question. And once the first round is done, we will go into the second round where we'll open it up for the panel to either add on to something which has been told or to contradict, whatever may be, we'll move it in that manner, and that at that point, we'll see how the discussion takes place. I will open it to the floor because I would like maximum participation from the floor. So that's how we are trying to go by. Mr. Subodh Kumar, he is with TCS, as I said, and he was with CII earlier. He's leading in the business, typically, as they say, the business initiatives, IP, head of IP business initiatives. And, Lakshika, did you inform? Okay, so I just saw one of my speakers, I've lost her. I'm sorry for that. So coming back to Professor Raman Mittal. Professor Raman Mittal is an associate professor, as I said, with the University of Delhi. He specializes in intellectual property, cyber laws, and very interestingly, he had spent time in Max Planck Institute in Germany. And I'll leave it at that. Professor Nedumpara, James Nedumpara, is specializing in international trade law, investment law, and the interface issues, and bringing in IPR from that perspective. Now, my first question would be to Professor Mittal, if you allow me. So, we talk, and by the way, both the professors have quite a number of publications and books also, and I happen to read a bit of one of his books on licensing. So if I ask you that IP licensing as a business model, what would be the, how do you look at it from a business strategy perspective? How do you think that it will work as a business model, or IP as a business model? How do you strategize? How do you work on it? And when you see the manufacturing model and the licensing model, how do you compare both, and how do you move forward? Well, when you talk of licensing model, it can be exclusive, non-exclusive. I leave it at that, and if you start with that, it will be lovely.
Does it work? Yeah, okay. Thank you so much. And I'd like to start from the very basic. All intellectual property grants us exclusive rights. Is that right? Exclusivity that we describe as. Now, what is the meaning of exclusivity? All intellectual property, whether it's copyright or patent or trademark, the statute or the law grants us exclusive rights. So what exactly do we mean by that exclusivity of rights? There's one kind of right. I have a right to go to the park and play there. But that's not exclusive, right? And I have a right over my car. Is that an exclusive right? Yes. So what is the exclusivity of IP? That means it has traditionally been and always been defined as right to exclude others. Right to exclude others. But in the beginning, I would like to make it clear that is only half an understanding. Because when we say right to exclude others, we forget it is also a right to include others. If I have my intellectual property, I can invite anybody to participate in the exploitation of that property. And if we have only one meaning or one side of meaning, that is the right to exclude, then our understanding is incomplete, I would say. And it's a very myopic view of the intellectual property system that we have. Okay, that is one thing. Second thing in this regard I would like to mention, I would like to pose a question, or I would like to say first, that there are three limbs of intellectual property system. The whole intellectual property practice can be divided into three parts. First, the creation of the property. Because intellectual property is not something that is found, that is to be found, that is to be invented, that is to be expressed, that is to be made, that is to be created, right? So the first limb is creating. Second is protecting. And the third is exploiting or utilizing. Creating, protecting, and exploiting, right? So now my question to you is, which out of these three comes first? The creation of the property, the protection of the property, or the exploitation of the property? Which comes first? Creation would come first. But let's now look into the market practices. For example, let me take an example from the copyright industry. There's a producer who wants to make a film. Right? What he's first looking for is looking for a script. Now he looks for a writer who is already established. The script is nowhere. He commissions him. He says, okay, would you like to write a script for me? I want to make a movie like this. He says, yes. Okay, how much time would you take? He says, I'll take, say, 3 months to write it. He says, okay, how much would you charge? I'll charge X amount of money. He says, okay, give me X by 2 upfront, and the rest when I deliver the script to you, right? Has creation of intellectual property come first here? What has come first? Not even protection. Exploitation. Let's go to another industry, software, let's say, or medicine. There's a company that wants to make an invention of a particular, or invention of a drug to treat a particular disease. It's not known, right? The company employs 100 scientists, tells them, okay, you need to discover, you need to invent this kind of a drug. Is the drug there? No. But upfront, there's a contract with all those employees. That, okay, you will work for me, this will be your salary, and this will be your incentive, and whatever you will invent during the course of your employment, the intellectual property of that will belong to the company. So the exploitation has already taken place. So our view that creation comes first, and then it's protection, and then exploitation, is when we examine the market practices of today, it's reversed. The exploitation, most often, I'm not saying always, but most often, the case is that exploitation comes first, and then only upon exploitation it is created. And intellectual property laws, all intellectual property laws permit it, whether it's patent statute or copyright or trade, it permits it in many ways, expressly and implicitly. Right? So I think I have responded to your initial questions.
Thank you very much. As you can expect, he explained it in his own way, which is very, very interesting. And of course, we will pick that up and discuss further. We have our next speaker, Ms. Lakshika Joshi. She is global IP head of a US-based global design engineering company called Aricent. And in Aricent, she is responsible for managing large transactions, framing policies, ensuring compliances, managing and monetizing IP. So I'll stop there. And before joining Aricent, she was very much a general counsel and head of IP with Nucleus Software. And what I should mention is something very important. Thomson Reuters and the International Law Association this year chose her to award her with the Women in Legal Leadership Power Award. So a very, very powerful person, as you can understand. And I bring Lakshika here with a question. Before that, when we talk of IP monetization, let us go back and see what's happening in India. The Indian government, quite rightly so, is pushing for manufacturing. The Indian government is, at least it's trying to focus in a manner that India becomes a manufacturing hub. That's what the endeavor is. Now, if we talk of that, what do we understand about manufacturing in a world where global value chain has taken, the turf is global value chain. Where there is a global value chain, the manufacturing is dispersed in different locations. In that scenario, what matters? And my friend, what matters is intangible assets. And when I talk of intangible assets, it is IP. Now, what's the scenario? Are we in India IP implementers or IP creators? We would definitely love to be IP creators. But for a long time, we have not focused in that area. Now we are changing laws, we are modifying our IP laws, we are telling not just be creative, also use the IP system. But the point is, it will not happen in one day all of a sudden. And in the morning, there were sessions on disruptive technologies. There were sessions on artificial intelligence. Now, when we are talking of manufacturing in a global value chain setup where IP matters, and just this Monday, last Monday, the World Intellectual Property Report was published by the World Intellectual Property Organization, and they have come out with the percentage of intellectual property in the manufacturing. And they say that IP or economic, the economic percentage of intangible assets is higher. So in that scenario, let me bring in my second speaker, Lakshika. Lakshika, how do you see the business models changing? Earlier, which was standard practice of IP. He mentioned about exclusivity, he mentioned about going beyond and exploiting, make the scenario ready for exploiting and then coming to creation, or maybe in some cases creation first and then protection. Now, when you come in, you have a background of service industry very much. Well, how do you see in the present scenario dynamics of conventional IP protection and the catering to, say, 3D printing, IP in the 3D printing area or the high-tech area? I'm not just narrowly defining it, I'm keeping it open. How do you see? You have 4 or 5 minutes.
Thank you. So in one word, if I can put it, it is absolutely disruptive, quote unquote. None of the traditional age-old norms that we've applied to licensing sort of apply any longer. I've seen it on both sides, on the service provider side and also as a product company. It's all becoming, the lines are getting diluted. I think I would agree with my previous speaker about exploitation coming in before creation, and that is the nature of IP. We are talking about IP monetization because it has the worth of getting exploited, and that's where we have to start targeting what that IP is. So when we are structuring licensing arrangements, we wouldn't even know what we would be creating with the partnership. It's virtually impossible to anticipate if you have a 3-year to a 5-year partnership with for co-invention, you wouldn't know what you would end up creating. Would it be patentable, copyrightable? Would you have trade secrets within it? Or would it call for some other line of IP that you would need for protection of what you create as a result thereof? And hence, it's very difficult for IP professionals, at least in-house, to figure out the levels of protections to seek for in those arrangements. And it goes only as much as is the foresight of the council who's sort of negotiating those deals. Because with the way the world is moving, with a lot of IoTs and artificial intelligence coming into being, we don't know. I mean, for all you know, you all have experienced auto prompts when you try to type out something on a search engine. So what happens when you, if you're a writer and you sit down to write a story, what happens when there are too many auto prompts and you just borrow sentences after sentences? Would you say that it is copyrightable? Would you say that the machine has half of the copyrights on it? How would you sort of qualify? And who owns that licensed software? So would you give the copyrights to the licensor of that software? Or would you, as the owner of that machine, have those copyrights because you bought that license? Or would it be someone else? We don't know. I mean, that's just a situation that one can foresee. And similarly, with many other technologies, what happens when you're talking of driverless cars? What happens if somebody happens to hack into the system and it crashes into, say, another vehicle? Would it be the person who's programmed the car? Would it be the company that runs the programming? Would it be the servers that are actually holding all of that software? And if there's a bug introduced at that level? Or would it be the person who physically owns that car and purchased it off the car manufacturer? We don't know. So as IP professionals, we are at a stage where things are so blurred, we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. And that has posed very interesting, very challenging situations for us because, you know, this is going to shape up how we behave, what we see. And I think it would be futile to sort of criticize that law hasn't catched up because that's always the way technology is. It moves faster than anything else. And we need to figure out then how will we construct ourselves when we do our licensing? How do we protect ourselves within the frameworks that we have? And also bearing in mind that the framework may change at some point in time. Are we equipping ourselves enough through our documentation and other aspects around that licensing that we'll be able to manage what is in store for us in future? I just have sort of these thoughts in mind and I wanted to share them, and we can dwell deeper into those when, sure, again, talk about it. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So you see, it gets more and more complicated. So she says that when you talk of applications, whether who would be, I mean, when everything goes hunky-dory, everything is fine, there's no problem. But when there is an issue, when there is a problem, how do you ascertain liability? How would you say that this is the fall guy, or this is where this guy should be penalized? So that's the essence of what she said, in the sense, IP, the statutes give you certain clarity, but not beyond, which means that we come back to contracts, which means that whether it is licenses, who would be liable for what, everything comes into contracts. Contractual essence is in the contractual understanding between two parties or multi-parties, whatever. Even then it is not clear. So at that stage, I think, when we are talking of contracts, Subodh, as a business lead, how do you manage IP ownership, especially in a large contractual obligations when you have? You are responsible maybe for the IP ownership part of it, and then you have, as we discussed, very practically issues on the contracts that's coming. So in general, if you look at your organization, how, as a business lead, would you manage IP ownerships in large contractual obligations that you have? And what do you think are the risks, IP risks, that is involved? And how do you mitigate it? Because the point is this, we are discussing it, not for the sake of discussion, but trying to sort out certain solutions, certain things which may not be clear absolutely that this is the solution, but we discuss and bring out certain solutions that you look at. How do you mitigate these risks?
Just coming to the point quickly, what Santanu has brought in, see, contractual agreements are what we have. They are a very, very specific intellectual property clauses within the contract, especially when we deal with our customers, whether it is a large bank or a large insurance company or a large diagnostic devices company. The evolution, and since we deal with a lot of customers who are based in US and Europe, the contracts are very well laid and the clauses of intellectual property are also very well laid. So when we get into a service agreement, there is a certain boundary on which we are very clear that the moment we enter into a service engagement with our customers, we know whatever we create belongs to the customers because there is a binding clause. But that is one part of the issue. Now what happens many a times that, especially an organization like us where we employ hundreds and thousands of people across various customer locations. While it's sacrosanct, we have the contractual agreements and people who understand the contracts and IP clauses, but there is a lot of workforce which will manage a set of projects. You know, because of the service sector nature of the business, they are subdivided into various projects. Now, the learnings what they get from the customers, and once they learn a certain piece of domain knowledge, maybe a solving, let's say, a banking problem, maybe it may be a payment problem. When they learn and when they come out of these projects and start applying that same knowledge into something which where we as an organization has to claim an ownership, that is where the conflict of interest comes, and that is where the understanding of ownerships becomes very critical. As long as it's a contractual agreement, we are clear. But then the moment you come out of the contract with the knowledge, with the skills, and start implementing in other areas, that's where the understanding of IP ownership becomes very critical. Because there you are using some of the knowledge and problem what customer has posed you. And you have to be very careful there. If you start using that as your IP, it becomes a legal issue. So when you come to the question of legal risks, what we actually do is we have a process by which we clear all these kinds of risks. risk coming from employers. You have some amount of cooling periods, or we have certain disclosures, certain declarations, employee declarations, and also processes to ensure that no third party IP gets into your assets or products or solution you build in. Okay, that's the employee part of it. And from the product architecture point of view, from the security, from the vulnerability, there are various engineering checks. So in a kind of a service driven organization like us, IP and engineering both go together. So it's a compliance of not just the IP part, mitigating the ownership and the risks involved, but engineeringly, when you are creating an architecture, when you are creating a security protocol, make sure that you don't have any third party IP into it. I think that's the way we manage the ownership and also mitigate the risks. And one more point I want to add, I think just coming from the discussion, just to add on to this, here the biggest challenge in a service sector, I would say, you know, the word value creation, you know, is something we all understand, you know, whether it is an airline business or a hotel business, you know, what value you're creating to a customer. But in a service sector, we have to go one step forward, especially the kind of business we have. Value creation means what are the value you add directly to their businesses as well. For example, if I am producing a solution to a banking customer, is he able to reduce cost in his business? Is he able to offer services at lesser time to the customer? Or whether if it's an insurance sector, how much his end customer is benefited? So the value creation goes beyond the conventional paradigms to be able to understand what bottom lines you impact, how the profitability is maintained, how the cost impact is minimized. So these are some of the challenges on which we have to build our IP and sustain our business. I think that's one perception I wanted to add in the whole discussion point of creation and exploitation.
Thank you. Thank you, Subodh. Thank you very much. So we see that the client is paramount in the sense what the client wants. We cater our licenses, we cater our contracts according to that. Of course, it is negotiated. Now, the point what comes after this naturally is that how much of client interest can we generate, whether it is for manufacturing, whether it is for the service interest, service industry, how much can we look at foreign direct investments coming into India? And when we talk of investments coming into India, quite often the discussion is how good is your IP regime or how effective is your IP enforcement mechanism. So we talk of IP enforcement, we talk of, and we tie investment with it. Now I am trying to reverse that and ask Professor Nedumpara, how much of IP enforcement or IP protection, or rather IP licensing is interest, licensing interest is there tied up with investment protection. In the sense, I am interested in bringing in my IP, but what investment protection do you have? How do, and of course, you are an academician for quite some time, but new in government. But still, if you can give me a presentation, if you can, for very short, we are absolutely in time. So,
yeah. In fact, this is a fairly interesting issue, because there has been certain discussion in the past that a very robust intellectual property regime will actually attract investment. So there have been so many studies, but the jury is still out on this matter. But generally, we can argue that if you provide a very robust and solid IPR regime, then the foreign investors will have better confidence in investing in the country. So I would like to actually talk about another phenomenon, which is basically the BITs. So if you look at the recent developments in the field of BITs, several countries have been coming up with regulatory measures sometimes it can be a price control, sometimes it can be a compulsory license, or sometimes it can be a plain packaging requirement, or sometimes actually denying a patent, saying that this product doesn't actually meet the utility conditions. So in all these areas, there is a certain amount of friction between the rights of the foreign investor, or maybe the private investor, and the regulatory capacity of the government. So that is why some governments actually argue that in a neoliberal world, the regime is actually skewed in favor of the private investors. And according to the new theories available in the field of developmental economics, the governments have been actually ceded away that particular kind of a freedom. The government can still allow the, you know, the government agencies to regulate prices, to introduce price controls. So these freedoms are still available with the government. To give an example to you, I think if you look at the pharmaceutical sector, you know, we have, the Indian government has actually given compulsory license on a product called, what is the name of the product? Yes, Nexava, right? And that is actually a subject matter of a big debate, actually. The second is basically the interpretation of section 3D of the IPR Act. So when you really look at these matters, it actually results in incursion of the right to the private investor. But at the same time, these kind of issues may also become a violation of the investment treaties. So assuming that there is actually an investment treaty between Netherlands and India, or maybe UK and India, the foreign investor can actually bring a case against the Indian government, which can meddle with the right of the government in providing access to medicine. So similar things have actually happened in a number of pharmaceutical products. So that is where there is a bit of clash here, and most of the governments would like to reassert their power, their authority, in actually enforcing these kind of freedoms. So my own feeling is that, you know, in the 21st century, most of the governments actually think that they have signed these treaties without understanding the implications. So the one clear example is basically the TRIPS agreement. And even now, the government of India officials basically say that had they given an option, they would not have signed the agreement. And the government again signed 86 BATs. And 58 BATs have already been terminated in the month of June or July. So these treaties are extremely complex. Sometimes the damages can actually amount to $2 billion. So there is a case between I think Ecuador and the United States where the damages has been around $1.8 billion. So when the government actually signs a friendly agreement with another country, they may not actually expect these kind of consequences. So that is one problem emanating from these kind of treaties. But I strongly believe that some kind of an international agreement is actually vital in giving to the private sector so that they can invest in the country.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. So you managed to put in a little bit of provocative thoughts, which is very good, in the sense that whether the promise of the statutory protection under patent law or any other law, that obviously follows a due process, and through the due process, if the courts decide that there is all reasons to reject a patent, whether that can be superseded by a treaty agreement between two parties. So we can get into that, and I love it. So that's very good. So at this, as I said, that I believe in maximum participation, I leave the floor open for some questions. I will bring them again, they will again speak. But there's no point if we do not have any participation. So any questions, not just restricted to what they have said, but obviously the topic, preferably what they have said. Any questions? Please. Please use it. Thank you.
Thank you for the enriching discussion. And my question is to the panel in general and Lakshita ma'am in particular. The question is, would you throw some light on the IP implications of artificial intelligence, because it is quite there in the popular media, but people do not know about the IP implications and it's quite complicated. And what do you think is the future of artificial intelligence in the Indian market space? Thank you.
Thank you. Let me try and understand the question. I thought you said how and where do we see IP going with artificial intelligence coming into the picture as creators, and is that the question?
Yes, okay. Ma'am, it is.
Okay, so of course, I don't know the answer. I'm not sure, and I'll be happy to know any answers. If anyone has any inputs, it will add to my knowledge. I don't know the answers. I don't think that the clear answers are available in the laws today across the globe. And I'm not limiting this discussion to only Indian laws. There is generally a tendency to be, overcritical of our own laws. But I think this is the way technology is. And the way the technology is moving, the pace is so rapid that I think laws across the globe haven't yet caught up with it. And it will be very difficult. So, there will be a lot of jurisprudence which will need to evolve around how this is to be seen, and where, things like liabilities and responsibilities with respect to warranties, etc., should rest, and therefore what happens in case of any specific breach or any kind of damages that are caused due to use of AI and so on. But clearly it's not really black and white at this point in time. And sorry, there was another part to your question, if you can sort of repeat that.
It was about what is the future of artificial intelligence in the Indian market? What would be the potential legal issues and what do you think is the future?
So I would not probably alienate Indian market. I would see it pretty much the same as probably rest of the globe. Just like any other business, if I can pick up the example of say a driverless car or anything else, for example, when any search engine came to this part of the world, they have to tweak their business to give it a local flavor. And similarly, I think all AI-based businesses will also need to do that. But that is in general how businesses operate. I don't see it differentiating so much on basis of jurisdiction so much. I think it's going to be pretty much the same as rest of the world. Perhaps it's going to be a little more difficult to decipher how to monetize that business in this part of the world, which anyways is the case with most of the businesses, because there is huge pressure of costs. There are concerns around protections. There are concerns around reverse engineering. There are concerns around implementations and execution. And those as business houses, I think they would know, having run many other businesses of similar nature.
I think there was another question there, and I will come to you. So we will definitely take it up. We'll take another question and then we'll come back to it. I will also share some views.
Anubha. Thank you. Anubha Sinha from Center for Internet and Society. I have a question for Professor James. So how do you think that international trade or investment agreements should be framed to protect the critical value of balance in IPR legislations? This is very important because the value of balance is key to protecting the rights of the IP owner as well as the user, often in the public interest of the latter. Thank you.
Any other question? Yeah, Rajiv.
Rajiv Chaudhary, thank you. Great panel. Going back to the topic, the role for IPR in local manufacturing, taking a model that is, IP centric, because the developed world and the developing world, there's a big divide. They had the capital, they had the technology. And once they start dictating the technology and the, terms and the laws to us, how do you think will that be good for Indian manufacturing? Indian manufacturing, you can have the example of, China and India, both of them were at a similar pace some decades ago, but the laws in China were tweaked to basically favor the local manufacturing, which is why you see China is so advanced in terms of manufacturing, you know, than India. And we see, you know, what we have over here. And in the beginning, Santanu, you used the words ecosystem and thrive. You know, what are the panel's views, you know, on the thing? Because we need to both the licensor and the licensee to thrive in that ecosystem. It can't be just one thrives and the other party will just go out of existence.
Thank you.
Yes, Ram.
Basic reason that you have the finest minds in India which go abroad.
Okay, I'll definitely take it. Yes, Pallavi.
Hi, my name is Pallavi. I'm not a lawyer, but I work a lot on open source licensing. And I constantly see this conflict between the freedom that open source licensing affords to the recipient of codes and softwares versus the R&D that the modifier is putting in, the effort that's going in, and their ability to commercially benefit from the value they're creating or adding to the software. How does the panel see the way this conflict will play out in the long run is my question.
Pallavi, if I can address that. See, we are talking about technology moving to IoTs and AI. So it has to be very collaborative with the open source environment and proprietary software. Many of the companies that were traditionally creating, building, or putting together only proprietary software are also using a lot of open source software. And it's open software is not treated as good or bad, and without being judgmental about it, I see that a lot of goodness is coming out of the collaborative efforts of companies that are traditionally putting together technology companies or service providers, ITES companies, and open source initiatives which are available. And having said that, there are fairly good amount of open source licenses like the GPLs of the world that are available that give you enough freedom to operate and yet be able to control what comes out of that end product. So I think I don't see any conflict as such. I see many things like the open source or the Creative Commons having come up and started with a good initiative where people wanted to do something which is more altruistic in nature and perhaps create a forum where they could create IP and yet not be bound by, you know, the limitations of sort of licensing norms and the licensing mechanisms available in the market. It started with that. Of course, in itself, it is slightly debatable because many of the open source creators on their own also release software that is then paid. So if you want to upgrade to higher versions of open source, you would realize that there's a huge licensing cost available to it. And although it all started with an altruistic objective, it very soon fell prey or is rather falling prey to the same age-old licensing, monetization universe, which in itself needs to be thought through. And this is perhaps something that the open source initiatives like the OSIs of the world need to think through and figure out how they want to control those creators or where and when they want to draw that line. So I think it is not a problem at all. It is something that, as in the ICT sector, everyone works with and is pretty comfortable with. We've all sort of come of age where we think that it is good or bad or are judgmental about it. We all work very seamlessly with open source initiatives and integrate it into products and stuff. Probably Subodh can add more to it. He comes from a similar.
Just to give the technology flavor to it, when you talk about artificial intelligence, I mean the word artificial intelligence, I think if you go to the really the brass tacks or the basics of it, you're making the computers systems more and more intelligent. You know, what differs between a computer and a human being is the human being's capability of intuitiveness and the cognitive knowledge. Okay. Now, we have various facets of artificial intelligence, whether it is machine learning, deep machine learning, you know, it's all advancing. Now, what is it making? It's making the systems more and more smarter, more and more efficient. So the biggest impact technologically would be you get better products, better services. Okay, having said that, the legal challenges, if you say, emanates from the fact that a lot of intellectual property is going to come from these investments, be it IoT, be it robotics, wherever you are applying artificial intelligence, there's going to be a lot of investment, a lot of intellectual property. So the challenge would be, how do we protect them? If you ask me from an IP angle, how do you protect them? Because a lot on artificial intelligence relies on algorithms, relies on the deep learning capabilities of the systems, and the experience which the computers and systems are put to, so that they learn and they overcome that barrier which a human being has, which is cognitive. And so it's becoming more and more closer to that. So the challenge would be, how do you identify the intellectual property, how do you protect it, and how do you protect it in various jurisdictions, because there are jurisdiction challenges as well. So these are, I would look at from an IP side, the challenges would be. But from the prospect side, always there is a talk, okay, look, robotics will eliminate human beings and there will be less people employed. It's the other way around. It's actually a very transitional phase where future, you will have different kinds of opportunities coming in. Not that it will replace human beings, but it will give new scope for new kind of employment opportunities. I think that's the direction, but we'll have to wait for it. So that's how I see from the opportunity side and the legal side of it.
Thank you, Subodh. Before I bring in Raman and James, let me give you an absolutely real-time example. When we pick it up, I do also sometimes teach, and this is an example where you have all different types of IP embedded. Whether there's copyright, there's trade secrets, there's patents, there's so many. Now the point is, each one type, there would be licensing, there would be different owners, there will be cross-licensing, all sorts of things happening. When you talk of AI, when you talk of artificial intelligence and products and services emanating from there, it is again, there would be bundle of rights. And the bundle of rights, it would not be just for AI, this exclusive type of IP. There will be all sorts of rights mixed in that. And there, that's why when it comes to licensing, the models will obviously get complicated, because even if you forget about AI, even if you talk of smart cities, where you talk of connected cities, you talk of having your drainage system controlled by stinky sensors, where the moment the sensors pick up, they work, or the basics of smart grids and smart switches. Everywhere there is complexity of IP in it, and the management of IP in it. So you cannot have one model going into that. Coming to Rajiv's point, very, very important. But what alternates we have? Have we created strength in the alternates? Because what he says is extremely important, because most of the developing countries, including very scientifically capable India, we are implementer society. Whether we should have, or what sort of policy space we should have, not to falter our international commitments, but at the same time, taking care of, as he says, pulling the implementers along with it, is important. And now, if I pick that up, I would say that negotiating licenses, are our implementer society, implementers, ready? Maybe there's need for capacity building. And again, that will bring back to James, that the government should do necessary capacity building so that the license negotiations is not one-sided because this dearth of capacity. Going Now, going to Ram's point, the government is definitely pushing R&D, IP creativity. Today's scenario is such, IP generating into, of course, there are different opinions as to whether in innovation is based on IP or IP relationship. I'm not going into the theoretical discussion of that. And I can happily stand corrected. But the point is, we have innovation, the government pushes for innovation, so we invest in R&D. Are we looking into a tiered form where I give you incentive for doing R&D, and then incentive plus incentive for that R&D maturing to patents or IP registration? And then again, because we are moving into an era where, whether it is AI, whether it is devices, small devices, whether it is whatever, smart cities, significantly standards are coming in, and they are all voluntary industry standards, but because they are being mass adoption of it, they become de facto, then they become de jure, because that's the way it goes. If that is so, how do we participate in that? Now, I would say that it is better that the third point is, as I said, first incentivize R&D, incentivize R&D going into IP, incentivize IP into adoption, Indian participation, adoption in standards. Then what happens is you are becoming a global player. If that happens, I think a lot you will see the implementer society gradually would move into the IP society. I will take the question later on before I give a fair chance to Professor Professor Mittal, because this is a relation, this discussion has gone very well. Now when we talk of the difference of licensing because of different IPs in there, what do you think of, I know in your work in licensing, you talk of differentiating IP licenses. Maybe you can shed some light on that.
Yeah, when we license, most of the license contracts, they address the issue of royalty. So we say that intellectual property is transferred through a contract in return of royalty. Now, what kind of intellectual property is transferred? We have to examine this. If, for example, in a transfer contract, which we popularly call a license, there's an element of patent in the technology, there's an element of copyright, and there's an element of trade secret as well. Now, if we say that royalty will be X per year or per unit sold or whatever measure, and then later on, and then to top it all, it'll be, this contract will be for 5 years or 10 years or whatever. Later on, we say one out of the bundle of intellectual property that was involved in the contract expires or is declared void by the court. What happens to the license? What happens to the royalty? Will the license as a contract subsist, or will it be declared as void? Second question is, what, even if it is valid, what happens to the royalty? So it's very important to stack the royalty as in accordance with the intellectual property involved. So we have to measure it. We can't just say that 5% of the market price, that, because that can land us in problems later on. That's not a smart legal decision. So when we say 5%, we have to break it out as well, that 1% is for this and 2% for this and 2% for this or whatever, right? So I think that will be a better legal solution to the problems that might arise in future, and that definitely our experience tells us that they do arise, right?
This is definitely interesting. So let me understand you right. You are saying that because, let's say, a tech transfer where there's a portfolio being licensed and there's trade secrets in it, there's maybe copyrights in it, and there may be, of course, patents in it. So you are talking of differentiated royalty rates for, I mean, that's definitely from a theoretical perspective, that's obviously that matters and that is possible, but in real term, especially in high-tech products like this, or we are going even more and talking of AIs and smart city devices and equipment going into smart cities. Will it be practically possible to differentiate royalty in that manner? Lakshika, do you have any views?
It would be really tough. Typically, it would be very business oriented to bundle it. And it would be tough. So I can understand that it'll be easy if you want to segregate patents from copyrights, and also because of the time frames available being very different from 20 years to 60 years and so on. But then you'll have to also segregate your trade secrets, and which means then you're clearly alienating where the trade secrets are, which ones are those trade secrets, and what those trade secrets are. You wouldn't want to, you know. The multiple times what happens is that those trade secrets are somehow bundled in and around your patents or your copyrights or the way you execute the project. So from a business perspective, very, very tough. It can be possible to an extent where you segregate copyrights from trademarks, from patents, but, you know, totally unbundling into various slices is practically perhaps not possible. And this is not from a legal perspective. This is from the experience of asking of engineers to do this, and they find it difficult to segregate it. So if the technologists are finding it difficult to segregate, I don't know how, as, you know, legal professionals, we would be able to help them do that.
So I will open it, although I do have, I have been given notice that I have to close. But given by the time that I started and I was told I will get 1 hour, so I will open it up, and I have seen Ojaswita one question, Rajiv one question, and then the concluding question I will ask James. Very quickly,
my
to the
question
point.
Is to Professor Nedumpara. So, the topic is monetization of intellectual property rights. And given the fact that the American IP intensive industry is worth $6.6 trillion, which is almost 35% of their GDP, and comparatively we are obviously far behind that. And also that, you know, the monetization or development of IPR as an objective in Make in India, how is it that the government is really going